Hey, y'all. It's Malveaux, and this is part of our second season, and I'm like so excited. I'm so excited. I have a good bud here, Ed Gordon. If you are over 40 and you don't know who he is, you had your head like in a bucket. If you're under 40 and you don't know who he is, this call Google. Ed Gordon is our griot. He has brought so many of us together in so many ways. He is a master of conversational interplay. And he has a new book called Conversations in Black, which is about conversational interplay. But even more than that, he's been with BET and TV1, and he's talked to just about every black person who had anything to say. The new book is, we're not gonna talk about it right away. We're just going to talk about some stuff. So, Ed, how long have we known each other?
We were talking about that in the makeup room. At least 25 years, probably a little over that. So, more than a quarter century now.
So, we've seen a whole lot of stuff together, haven't we?
We've seen a whole lot of things, been involved in a whole lot of things, been present for so many things. I mean, I think you and I could safely say that, you know, we've been blessed to be able to see some of the world's greatest stories up front, on the front lines, as opposed to reading about them or having someone tell us about them. And so I always tell people, you know, the engagement of yourself in life, you know, we're starting to lose that with this phone and everything. And I don't want to sound like, you know, the old neighbor who wants you off the grass, but there is something to be said for living life.
You know, hell, we are the old neighbor who wants you off the grass.
No question. And I embrace mine. I mean, I don't dye my hair. I don't try, you know, in my industry, that's all they tell you to do. Dye your hair, look youthful. Well, you know, you can do the math. I've been around X number of years. It's real easy. My birthday's out there. I'm 59 years old. So, but the point is, at some point, you know, virtual reality, virtual intelligence, artificial intelligence, whatever you want to call it, is fine. But you want to live your life and you want to experience it one-to-one, I hope.
Well, you know, one of my funniest experiences was a young brother. I am still cute. But a young brother who rolled up on me and he said, how old are you? And I said, 66. And he, eyes got big. He said, really? You as old as my mama? I said, uh-huh. And I said, so keep that in mind. Mm-hmm. Brother man said, well, you should tell people that you're 50. I said, but if I did, what 16 years of my life would I give away? Mm-hmm. You know, would I give away my Motown years? Would I give away my Black Panther years? What years would I give away? If I said I was 60, I would be giving stuff away that I cherish. Even though, you know, being over 60 is interesting for a sister. But I manage it. How do you manage it?
Just being real about what life is. You know, you dye your hair, you can tell people you're you know, under the age you actually are. You can, you know, wear different clothes, but you're still the age you are.
Yeah.
You know, it when I hear it's nothing but a number, but it's still a number. I mean, you're a numbers person, right?
Yes,
so it's
exactly.
Still a number. It's still a number. And so I just live my life comfortably, whatever I'm comfortable with. Sometimes I might wear something to my daughter who's 25, go, Daddy, why you got, because I like it. You know, and I think, you know, once you're good.
One of my nephews one day called me Hooch. Hooch! I did have a short skirt on, but the boy said, I'm Julianne, you look hooch.
I think though, once you're comfortable, and I think age does this, you know, once you're truly comfortable within your skin, you're good.
Exactly. And we think about some of our elders, you think about Dr. Hyde, who passed in her 90s. Mm-hmm. We think about, you know, Dr. King, who did not have the opportunity to live to be past 39. We think about so many of our folks who, Elijah Cummings, who was in 68, 69, who we all adored. And we think about, you know, that, you know, one of the things that's hitting me as an elder, which I hate to say, but whatever, I am, is the opportunities that we often miss when we don't cherish age.
I think about people like Ron Walters.
Oh, God, yeah.
Right? Ron Brown. And I was supposed to be on the plane with Ron. And just circumstance. So for those that don't know, Ron Brown.
Secretary of Commerce.
Secretary of Commerce.
Head of the DNC.
Head of DNC.
Amazing black man.
Arguably the main reason Bill Clinton became president.
Not arguably. You know, certainly.
Trying to be nice. But he was a mentor of mine. And we had traveled the world together. He would invite me often, and he invited me on this trip. He said, Ed, it's going to be great. We're going to have some business leaders. And he said, I want people to see me, because he had just gone into the Secretary of Commerce. I want people to see me go to a different spot. He didn't want to go to Africa. He didn't want to go, you know, with traditional black trips. And he said, you want a seat on the plane? And I said, yeah. He said, I can give you two, one for a camera person, one for yourself. I said, what's the date? He gave it to me. I said, all right, that sounds good. I said, but that date, something rang funny in my head. I said, I'll call you tomorrow and let you know. I went back, and I was to be a presenter at the Soul Train Awards on that date as well.
Pound Brown Soul Train.
So, but I had committed. I had committed to them. And so I called him and I said, hey, Ron, I got to take the next one. I'm already committed. And that's the only reason I wasn't on that plane. And, you know, that plane went down and we lost a lot of good people.
We lost a lot of good people, and I don't think we'll ever have another Ron Brown in terms of his ability. One of the things he always said was do well and do good. Mm-hmm. And that was like one of his. But the other thing is the way that he, despite the fact that he was as black as you and I, mm-hmm. was able to bridge gaps or not create bridges between, in the words of Roland Martin, crazy-ass white people, mm-hmm. you know, and us.
Mm-hmm. No, he was an extraordinary politician.
Yes.
Right? He didn't run for office, but an extraordinary politician. He understood the dynamics of not alienating, but still being strong in your position. And that's an art. You know, a lot of people who want to be strong in their position do it in a way that alienates.
Yes.
And Ron was able to massage a situation and still be strong, still not give what he wasn't prepared to give in the beginning, and make it work and never lose his sense and his balance. And so I think about Johnny Cochran, who was another mentor of mine, you know, again, these people who entered my life and, you know, gave me guidance and let me hang around when I was maybe, you know, not a peer, but for whatever reason they saw something in me and they let me, you know, peek behind the curtain or stand behind the door. Just extraordinary people. And I hope that their legacy lives in some way through me and what they gave me.
So you mentioned Johnny Cochran and, of course, Ron Brown. Is there another that sits out in your mind as someone you would lift up as a serious mentor?
I think to a great degree, there's so many people. You know, Johnny and Ron took real hands-on. But, I mean, even just being around Jesse Jackson as I was for many, many years, I wouldn't call him a mentor in the same way that Ron was or that Johnny was, but Rev has always allowed me around. He's never said, no, you can't come. He's never told me to leave a back room if I was in there. And he knew that I would respect what I knew was not for public consumption. And there are just so many people who really have blessed me. I mean, you know, I take a look. You, I would count as that. You know, when I came to D.C., when I started at BET, you know, still wet behind the ears, so to speak, didn't know anybody per se. No one knew me. But there were a handful of people who just said, you know, yeah, I'll come on the show, or yes, I'll do that. And I haven't forgotten them, and I've tried to, which is why I think I've been able to assemble the people that we assembled for this book. I've tried to maintain not only just cordial and good relationships, but to show my appreciation to people through the years who I knew did for me, you know, before I became, quote, Ed Gordon. And so, you know, never forget that, always appreciate it. And I tell my daughter now, you know, talent is a small portion of what you do, but relationships at the end of the day is what carries you through.
Speaking of your daughter, you blessed me amazingly when you came to Bennett College while I was president. And you gave a great talk to the girls, but one of the things you talked about was your initiative. Was it Daddy's Promise. It was so exciting to me. I am, my mom was a single mom, five of us. My dad was a brilliant man, but he wasn't quite the family type, if you will. He was a mathematician, so I guess I got a little bit from him. And I have two sisters who are MBA, so we did too. But the whole notion of the father-daughter relationship, people often talk about the father-son relationship, but not the father-daughter relationship. And you were really talking about how to nurture that. Because, you know, I think that when black girls don't have a good relationship with their dads, they're very vulnerable to, for want of a bit, to a lot of nonsense.
Yeah, so. I think that the dynamic of having two parents, while you don't have to have that, obviously, I think the dynamic of having two parents is a strong dynamic that too often is missing in our community. And for me, I always wanted to be a parent. I always knew, even when I was little, you know, I'm going to be married one day and I'll have a family one day. And but I always envisioned a boy, right? Mm. So little Eddie, he played basketball, you know.
Little Eddie.
Yeah, roll in and pick up the cuties and all that. You know, so I wanted a mini me, right? And then I found out that wasn't in the cards and that I was going to have a little girl. And so my brother said, who had a daughter, yeah, you just don't get it yet before she was born. She said, this person will love you different than your wife, different than your mom. It's going to be special. And then I had this blessing in pink instead of blue. And we have had a fantastic relationship ever since she came to this world. And so I wrote an article for Essence about our relationship. And that's what spurred the initiative, Daddy's Promise, because the return that we received from people after that article was published was unbelievable. You know, women just talking about either it touched them because it reminded them of their relationship with their father, or it gave belief to women who had become jaded with a father-daughter relationship because they had no relationship with their father. And so we created Daddy's Promise, had a wonderful run of it. And in fact, over the course, now, 10 years late, 12 years later now, Taylor's grown, 25 years old, living in Los Angeles. But people have asked us to resurrect the initiative. And it really was just the salute to the relationship between a father and a daughter.
So how long did you all maintain the program?
About 3 or 4 years. People wanted us to create programs and come and give seminars, and I just didn't have the time.
Right.
You know, it wasn't my day job, and it wasn't.
Yeah.
But I did see it as a calling. I thought it was something, and that I had the ability to raise the visibility of that relationship. And, you know, give it some wings and some breath. And so that's what we tried to do.
You know, it's interesting because really there is such a focus on young black men, which I don't think is inappropriate. There's a focus on young black men, the father-son relationship.
Right.
But very few. I think B.B. Moore Campbell once wrote about the father-daughter relationship.
Yes.
And I think others have. And, you know, I would say for my own space, you know, my dad and I have a lot in common, but we did not get along. Atoll. Of course, most people don't get along with me, so that's not a big deal. But it was.
Then I've been lucky for 25 years.
Well, it was interesting because it's just one of those things where whatever came out of the history, but there is also something that I think I missed in terms of just not being very close to my father.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think there's a dynamic you get from your mother. I think there's a dynamic you get from your father. And if that's not there, I my daughter's name is Taylor. Taylor and I were talking the other day, and it was about one of her girlfriends and a situation she was in with an older gentleman. And so she was talking about that, and I said, so what did you, she goes, Daddy, no, I already know. She said, I would have never even walked that road. She said, because I know what that would be like. And I've told Taylor, I said, you know, I don't care what the law says about you being grown and adult. I'll always be your father. And if I thought genuinely you were in a situation that was detrimental to you, I wouldn't give a damn what the law said. I'm coming up in there. And she understands that. And I mean that through love.
And more young ladies need to have that.
Yeah.
I mean, as a, you know, former women's college president, I mean, you see a lot, you see the bond between fathers and daughters as very strong. you see a bond that's not so trusting. Like, I had a couple dads who had tracks on their daughter's phones, mm-hmm. which is how they found mm-hmm. stuff out. But you also see the young ladies who, I mean, I had a child who was dating somebody who was 50-some years old. I'm like, I wouldn't date him. you know, but there are men, and I'm not dissing men, who know the vulnerability sure. of women who have not had male
attention. I think often you can tell who had a father and who didn't if you're in a relationship with a woman. But I think, too, we have to understand that we give our children foundation, then you have to let them go.
Yes.
You know, I have friends who gave their children everything, and the child was just a wayward child. And I have other friends who really, you know, have given their child everything. The child picked up what they needed, and they've carried on and had wonderful lives. And so I've told Taylor and the other children I've mentored and fathered to a great degree, not biologically, but I've said to them, listen, you know, all I want from you in terms of what I'm giving you is when you, I say, and you're gonna mess up in life and there'll be consequences and you'll have to pay for those faux pas. But I said to them, I just want, when you're really getting ready to do something just stupid and could be life-threatening, that you hear my voice, you know, that will save you from the big one. And that's it. Because you got to let them live. You got to let them fly. That's what they're here for.
That's a part of it. Yeah. So what do you tell dads with daughters who need to sow into them?
I tell fathers just in general, with daughters or sons, to be present first. You know, a lot of brothers I know put it on the circumstance why they aren't with their kids. Oh, the baby's mama won't let me. You know, I got to work and pay for them because she ain't. That's all malarkey, as our friend Joe Biden would say.
yes, he would.
I also tell them that you're missing out on something. You know, I can think of certain moments with my daughter that I wouldn't trade for anything. And it wasn't a money thing. It wasn't, you're missing out. You know, often we think about the child missing out when a parent isn't there. But I try to tell people, yeah, but as a parent and as an adult, you're missing out too. There's certain magical moments that happen. You know, there are certain moments that I literally get teary-eyed when I think about with Taylor. And so I wouldn't trade those. How do I get those back if I weren't there?
That's so interesting. You know, I ran for public office in San Francisco in 1984. My dad and I didn't get along at all, but he came to one of my fundraisers. He didn't say nothing. He sat in the back. Mm-hmm. We kind of looked alike, same nose. Mm-hmm. He didn't say it, utter a syllable, but when I went into the cash, you know, you pass the hat, $1,000 mm-hmm. check, mm-hmm. he didn't say nothing. And when I called him, I said, well, I want to say thank you. And he said, it was really a very poignant mm-hmm. kind of thing. It's like, okay, I cannot stand your crazy behind, but I am proud of you, and I'm mm-hmm. hook you up.
mm-hmm. you and know? You wouldn't trade that?
No, I wouldn't.
That
I mean,
moment.
I think I may still have that picture, but yeah. it's really, he's yeah. looking at me, and someone took the picture, and the look is like such an ambivalent look. It's like, I love you, but you're crazy. Mm-hmm. you know, which I think 2/3 of the universe would say. But I mean,
but you know, a lot of times too, we see ourselves in that person too. You know, when Taylor and I, there was a period where Taylor, you know, in her teens and early 20s, I was like, where's that little thing that thought I was everything? You know, so you got to go through some of that. But I also saw some of the bigger blow ups we had. I realized that a lot of what brought that on was the me in her.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And so some of that I had to blame myself for. I was like, dude, that's you. Right?
that's so, amazing. So give us an update on Taylor.
So Taylor is now 25. She works at a marketing and PR firm out in Los Angeles. She lives with one of her what I call my might as well be daughters. They grew up together, yeah. And they're good people more than anything. And so she's flourishing, and I don't have a care in the world other than their safety, because I know that we've given all of her little crew that we all helped raise. You know, we were that village. Mm-hmm. We gave them the foundation. And so now, you know, it's up to them to utilize it. And all I do is pray for their safety. And at that point now, it's up to them.
You know, what you're saying to me is that it takes a village.
It does.
Is that,
absolutely.
You know, some young people are blessed to have two parents in the house. Some are not so blessed. Some are blessed to have professional parents who can hook them up. And some are not so blessed. But you obviously have taken the village concept. Have enough of our people done that?
I don't think so. And I think it goes beyond just the family. You know, when I talked about coming to D.C., you know, 30 plus years ago, meeting you, meeting Ron Brown, meeting all of the folks, Reverend Jackson, and all of the folks that you mentioned, Dorothy Hyde and others that have left us since. That was part of a village thing too, mm-hmm. right? The fact that, you know, as I said, you would come on my show before anyone knew who I was, or Reverend would, you know, and I knew Reverend from my days in Detroit, but still people took me in. And that's part of that family feeling too.
You were a good guy.
Yeah, but you know what? You don't have to take a person in. You know, it was more than just stopping in. You know, if I needed something, people would answer the phone. So I think African Americans survived through that familiar feeling that we had and connection that we had. And I do think it's waned and maybe crumbled a little bit, and that we need to get it back. You know, we say, hey, sister, hey, brother, but the feeling isn't the same, in my estimation, as it was years ago when we said it. There was a closeness.
Well, how come, though? What happened?
I think the world changed. And I think that we bought into some of the things that were not in our DNA. You know, mm-hmm. we are a kind people, in spite of how we're portrayed in this country, right?
Ooh.
We are a warm people. We are and listen, I'm not saying that there aren't bad black folk. Of course there are, and all the
there's
things
bad,
that come along
kind of
with
people.
It, right? But there's the point. And so I think that we need to start to think about where we came and what kept us, and go back to that.
You know, Ed, you have a new book out mm-hmm. that I'm very excited about. I'm in it. That's not why I'm
indeed
excited
you
about
are.
It. But you've got about 30 voices.
40 plus.
40 plus voices. Jemele Hill, Michael Eric Dyson, all these interesting black people. When I was looking at the PDF, which you so kindly sent me to prepare for today, I was thinking, this is an Ed Gordon book. Because what I think you're best at is managing conversations mm-hmm. among us. I mean, you've done other things, you've had great interviews, but I think that you've had people around the table. And I think the only person, and I'm gonna go there, but there are a couple other people who've done it, Tavis Smiley, of course, others, but your way of weaving people together is unique mm-hmm. and knowledgeable. And I was just saying to you before we got in here, I said, we taped the conversation we had when you called and said, hey, do you want to give me an interview? And I'm like, no, I don't want to give Ed Gordon no interview. I got other stuff to do. But that I don't think that's what I said, but I might have. But, you know, when you explain the book to me, I'm like, oh, this is fascinating. And the book is fascinating from that perspective. What made you want to do it now?
You know, I started the project in 2012, the thought of it. And I actually made a couple of calls to people and started interviewing people. And then I got another project and had to put this one aside. And then I just started looking at the world and where we sat and all that was going on in America and in the black community. And I said, let me pick this project back up. And because I've had entree to various people and amazing interviews and conversations, sometimes not for air, just over lunch or what have you, I thought, man, wouldn't it be great if I could bring some of these conversations to people? And I said, wouldn't it even be better if all of us could have been in the same room? But I knew that was an impossibility, just for sake of people's schedules.
Well, the book reads like you've had everybody.
But
in the
I said, I can be the linchpin to all of that. And so I interviewed all of the 40 plus, and then I put it together as a virtual conversation. And what we're finding is it did end up reading as if we were all together.
In the room. No, it really did. I mean, I was reading and kind of laughing And I had moments where I was like, he didn't ask me that. But it was very rich. What do you expect people to take out of it?
I didn't want it to make it too academic. I didn't want it to make it too wonky. I didn't want to make it too political for those who aren't policy heads. I wanted this to read like we were all sitting around at Christmas at the Thanksgiving table, in the backyard at the barbecue, in the beauty shop. And I want people to just start to think about having serious conversation and moving to actionable items, because that's the thing. We like to talk, right? Mm-hmm. We have more town hall meetings. We have more panel discussions. We all gear up for the CBC week. I saw you and I told you I ain't coming next week, and I didn't. And then, I come like every other year now because I feel like we're having the same conversations over and over. And so
I only go if I have something to add.
Right.
I'm just gonna go hang out, I don't go hang out if I'm on somebody's panel or something. And I do appreciate what some of the members of Congress do to bring voices to the table.
Absolutely.
Around the stuff that I do, economic
Absolutely.
Development.
But if we don't have actionable items, right?
And that's important.
Then what we're doing is just having an annual discussion. And so what I'm hoping this book will do is move people. We're asking people to read it as a group, as we were a
group.
Yeah,
and group. Actually, you actually have,
yes.
Start your own conversation.
Read it as a group, and then say, what are we going to do?
So three things from you, Ed Gordon. Yeah. What are you telling Black folks we need to do? Three things.
Julie, I'll answer that. I won't skate it. But, it's interesting because I've never seen myself as that person. I've always tried to be a very traditional journalist, as you know. Mm-hmm. I'm not an advocate journalist. I mean, that's Roland's thing. That's Tavis's thing. I let that be what it is. I've always
but
seen myself.
But you've talked to a lot of
and
people.
And I have.
So
and
you,
I have.
So
I'm not skating it. I'm not skating
that are not conclusions
it. Yes, ma'am.
That are
yes, ma'am. Yes,
conclusions.
Ma'am.
I mean,
so I will tell
to 40
you.
People.
I will tell you. The first thing I would tell us is to stop simply talking.
Okay.
Right? So there are complaints all the time. Someone asked me yesterday, what are we going to do if Trump wins? Well, damn it, you need to go somewhere else then, because there's no reason he should win. Right? You control, what are we
going
to have to, you have the
passport.
Narrative now though. You have the narrative,
yes.
And the ability to change that now this year. And if you don't, shame on you. You should go put your head in the sand if he wins, because it'll be our fault that we didn't get out there. More registered Black Democrats than Republicans, right? So if you just sheer numbers, get out there, he won't win again.
We got to keep it up. We're going to keep it up because I asked you for three things and you gave me one. But we're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
I came to UDC because I knew that I could get a really good education, but I wouldn't be in debt for the next 40 years of my life.
This is not your typical HBCU. We have a lot of different populations and international students and students such as me.
We all have one thing in common, is our persistence. With the help of UDC, I feel like I got to know a lot of cultures, and it's really amazing to see how people think and where people come from.
One thing that makes UDC so unique is that it encompasses all the definitions of what diversity means, not just in terms of racial diversity, but in terms of socioeconomic background.
I fell in love with UDC because the people here are awesome. I met my roommate here. I've been pushed to think about courses outside of undergrad. I'm now anticipating going to grad school once I graduate.
I do enjoy the quality of the academics here offered at UDC because of the interpersonal relationships that you get to build amongst your peers, the faculty and the staff.
The sincere knowledge that they try to deliver to each student one-on-one, they push you so hard to learn, and they're very sincere about that.
We have MIT and Harvard trained professors here. One of my teachers actually worked at Columbia University's counseling center. So the teachers here are the same caliber that you're getting everywhere else.
I know all my teachers personally, which has given me a lot of opportunities. I might even be working with one of my professors on research papers, which means I can be published in my second year of college, which is huge.
I was granted a scholarship, a full scholarship to Europe, to study the history of psychology in Paris and London.
With the guidance of my teachers and my peers, I've been able to acquire research experience. I'm applying to go to conferences. I'm now doing interviews that'll help me prepare for grad school.
I had never ever thought that UDC was, you know, a beaming source of opportunities out there for me.
I found that UDC is offering me the right things that I needed to become successful.
Welcome back. It's Malveaux with an exclamation point, because anytime I'm in the room, there is an exclamation point. Right, Ed Gordon?
That's right, sister.
So we are, I'm talking to Ed Gordon, who is just a, he is one of our griots. He's brought Black people together over the course of his 3-decade career, putting us in rooms on MSNBC and BET and wherever, moderating town halls and panels, and really having the unique ability to weave our stories together. And he's done that again in this amazing book called Conversations in Black. So we're gonna talk about that in a minute, but I wanna continue. I asked you, you said that, you know, we have conversations, what are we gonna do? So you gave me one thing.
You want two more.
Yeah, I want two more. You know me, I'm numerical.
I understand, I think that we have to start to decide that we are in control of our lives, not our destiny. People misuse that word. Destiny is not controlled. Destiny is going to happen. But the truth is, Johnny Cochran said something to me. He said, Ed, the only thing that you have control of in chaos is the way you react in chaos. And so what I keep telling folks is we can keep complaining about whatever the ill is, or we can change the circumstance for us in that ill. And so I'll use the NFL as an example. Colin Kaepernick. We all say, yeah, Cap, you're right. Let's do it. We're going to boycott. We're going to. And then the season starts.
And all y'all brothers start watching that.
And then the season starts. And it's not just brothers. Sisters watch football, too. Oh,
you're right.
All right.
Okay, I don't watch none of that mess.
I understand. But what would happen if, in fact, the majority, because you're never going to get 100% lockstep, but the vast majority of African-American NFL players said week two of next season, we all going to get sick. Just for 1 week. Just for one
week. 50% of them did it.
So these actionable items that we say that we need to be able to move on and control that can really sway situations, as opposed to letting that one lone wolf stay out there and say you're backing him, and back him or her to a certain degree, but not really move. You know, we talk about, it's almost cliche-ish, but we talk about the Montgomery bus boycott. That was extraordinary. People don't
We've
know how long it went on.
That. It was a year.
It was more than a year. And they did not get on that bus.
They did not get on the bus. People found alternative ways of transportation.
Extraordinary.
The legal system came down on the sisters and the white women who were saying, let me drive you. So then they were charged with illegal whatever.
Co-conspirators. It was amazing. It was amazing.
But people did not bend.
They did not bend. And we have the ability to do that again.
But we have not seen that in a long time.
No, we have
time.
Not. I would argue that you haven't seen it since.
You're probably right.
In that way, where you had the vast majority of people who stuck to it, you know, and who made a nation, even though it was that city, who made a nation change.
It made a nation look first, and as they
and ultimately changed,
they had to change
at the end. Yeah.
So, what's my number three?
Number three, I would tell you, I think that we need to start looking at people who have taken what we always said we need to do and put it into action, and that's the entrepreneurial side of, because I think that is economics and dollars is where we have lagged behind more than any other sector. And I'm blown away with what Tyler Perry has done.
Oh, yeah.
I'm blown away with what LeBron James is doing. You know, you don't have to like Tyler Perry's art to appreciate
appreciate his entrepreneurship.
That's exactly right.
And he
That's
really,
exactly
I mean,
right.
It's not fine art. It's not high art.
And it doesn't have to be.
But it's generating dollars.
That's
and guess
exactly
what?
Right.
There are a whole lot of melanin deficient people who have made a whole lot of money.
Woody Allen. Look at what Woody Allen has made the same movie 400 times. They deemed him a genius, right? And then we later found out some other things.
A genius and a
freak. Right? But no one wanted him to change and make a different movie because they said it was intellectual. Now look,
You know what? I was a Woody Allen freak back in the day. And I think I might have saw my third
Well, you might want to change that.
Well, not
Woody Allen
like
freak,
that.
Yeah.
But I enjoyed his movies
there
because they were thoughtful. And then I think maybe the fourth one, and I took some real hood brother to see one of those movies. And he looked at me, he said, do you enjoy this?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, actually, no. We just left in the middle. I mean, it was one of those movies where it was high art and the violin and, you know. But
or so they tell us it's high art. And
but it was
we
the
buy
same
into
story.
Yeah,
it was
is.
The same story that
it
he
is.
Told over and over and over again.
And so what? Look at what Madea has allowed him, because all of this is built on that character. Right,
mm-hmm.
All of the fortune that he's amassed is built on that character. And so he's been able to broaden his power, his reach, his scope through entertainment, but moved past that. LeBron James has done the same kind of thing. And so I think we have to start to find what you have been preaching for a long time and others, the idea of ownership
mm-hmm.
and the importance of it and being your own boss and not having your life turned over if someone just on a whim or a bottom line of a ledger says you're expendable now.
And even more than that, Ed, it's about how we begin to support each other.
Yes.
We have so many dollars in our community. I mean, we can't close the wealth gap by buying from black people. Let me be clear about that. We can't do that.
Right.
But at the same time, we could create more jobs, create more opportunities when we began to support each other.
And that's why in one of the chapters in the book, I talked about that, and you speak to that specifically. You and Butch Graves and Marilyn Booker from Morgan Stanley and others talk about Tracy Maitland, who's one of the richest African Americans in the country, talk specifically about the need to not only broaden our scope in terms of the businesses we get into and what we look to, but what I'm trying to do with this book is look for new narratives.
Mm.
And, you know, get us to look in other areas. You know, there's a chapter called Am I Black Enough for You? And we like to say we're not monolithic, and that's true, but we are a people of majority thought, as I call it.
And we're judgmental people.
We can
we're
be.
Very judgmental
we
people.
We can be. I mean, and I use the example, an easy example for people to buy into, and that is pumpkin pie versus sweet potato pie. If you're a black person and you ask for some pumpkin pie during Thanksgiving, you almost run out the house. So, I mean, you know, so there is majority thought for us, but we have to leave room for those who like the pumpkin pie.
And we have to deal with the fact that, as you say, black people are not monolithic. That, you know, one of my most interesting experiences as a college president was that I decided to have a diversity training on a black college campus.
Mm-hmm.
Why did I do such a thing? First of all, because I'm crazy. But secondly, because everybody thinks HBCU, everybody black.
Mm-hmm.
Well, faculty is black, white, whatever. And you have, even among the black umbrella, you have people who are Caribbean and African, not African American, African. And there are some barriers that we
sure.
have among all of that. And we I don't think as a people we've come to grips with some of that, which causes us lots of barriers, lots of challenges.
Well, and we're still hung up on things that we should have dropped a long time ago. The question of, you know, skin differentiation in our community. There's still, you know, the light versus dark. And I tell people, well, if that's gonna be your line of what's black and what isn't, then you're telling me that Clarence Thomas is blacker than Louis Farrakhan. Do you really want to stay with that, right? So I think there's a lot for us to talk about in a real sense, not just behind closed doors. I think that we are at a very crucial time with this president. He's opened some doors and some old wounds and really gotten this nation to see that maybe we hadn't come as far with race as we thought.
Exactly. So let's flip back to your book. You've got the Lottie-Dottie and everybody in this book. You got Michael Eric Dyson and Iyanala, Maxine Waters, Eric Holder, Jemele Hill. You've got really great mix of younger voices, established voices, across the spectrum. What got you to, how'd you pick the people that you put into the book?
You know, I wanted to your point, get cross-generational folks. I wanted to get slightly different views, but I didn't balance it out in the say, okay, I've got three women, I got two men, I got one conservative. I just tried to kind of get as broad of a voice as I thought represented Black America. And, you know, somebody might say, well, it's unbalanced here, or you should have done this, or you didn't talk about that. Yes, that's right. But I wanted it to be what you do in a backyard barbecue. You don't talk about everything at that one barbecue. You don't solve the world's issues at that one barbecue. This is one discussion.
You don't kick anybody out the barbecue because there's nobody who has another opinion. you can still talk your mess.
Yeah, but I just wanted each topic to hold on its own. So we do the Trump years, we do an Obama reflection, we talk about Black leadership. What I appreciate most of all is that people were very candid. You know,
well,
I mean,
that's what you do, though. You bring it out.
I like to believe that, but I appreciate that, you know, there's some people who said, hey, you know, I love Obama, but dot, dot, dot. And, you know, that isn't often the case for us in public. Black leadership, you know, when you look at the kind of measurables that we say is the advancement of a people, mm-hmm. education, economics, wealth gap being closed, last 25 years, pretty stagnant, or we've regressed
in
that.
We've gone backward on the wealth gap.
So if in fact that's the case, who do we look to? What are we asking leadership? We don't ask them much.
But that's a really great question. So one of the, you have two chapters that are gender-based, mm-hmm. one about the brothers and one about the women. We've mm-hmm. had these conversations in the past about mm-hmm. the gender mm-hmm. relationships in the Black community. I don't think we're on the same page, but we have had the conversations. Help me talk about what we need to do to be closer together as men and women.
Well, I think that we have to acknowledge some of the things that just come with the idea that, you know, Venus and Mars thing. That's
yeah.
the natural thing. Okay,
yeah,
we'll accept that.
No,
nope,
exactly.
We don't. We speak whatever we speak. We grunt, as we like to say. But that being said, I think that there has to be something that's a vested interest beyond the personal experience, the one-to-one experience, you know, the sexual experience, the emotional experience.
So are too many of us casual empiricists?
Well, yeah.
And we take our experiences and this is what...
That's exactly right. Yeah. That's exactly right. I mean, I think about what Lonnie Love, the comedian, went through the other week when she said, no, you know, Black men couldn't be faithful and she's dating a white guy. As she talked about it,
I missed
you
that,
could but. Hear in her voice that this was emotional for her. This was also personal for her. And so I think what we all have to begin.
White men are hoes, and she said that Black men.
I'm just going to continue. Thank you.
Never mind. They could probably edit that part out.
But I think that we have to just accept that we are all better together, mm-hmm. right? So I lost my father when I was 11. My mother was the most important guiding fact and factor in my life, but without the man who became my mentor, who lived two doors down, I would not have become the man I became. Mm. So this sense of, I hear women say sometimes, I don't need no man when they have children. These are my babies, my babies. Well, yeah, they're your babies, but they're also the man who impregnated you. They're his, whether he's around or not, they're still his children. And yeah, you're doing a fine job in some cases, not in all cases. You're doing a fine job in some cases in raising. You and I talked about this, I remember, during the interview, because you said, well, my mom was a single mother. And I'm not impugning any single mothers. I'm not suggesting. I would still say the dynamic of a male in that household, or at least in the lives on a consistent basis, would make for an easier road. I won't even say better children, but an easier road and a different perspective for all of us, My perspective would have been vastly different had Fred Hudson, and me being 59, I still call him Mr. Hudson. I've never called him Fred in my life. I would not have been the same man. There are dynamics that men teach boys that women can't, and vice versa.
But what, so 45% of black children are raised in female head households. Is it 45? Well, that's a low number.
I was going to say, I think that's the low number, yeah.
Because it could be higher. And I, when I look back at my own upbringing, I mean, whatever, my mom did an amazing job to have five kids, to work, you know, as she worked, didn't get to do what she wanted to do,
right.
Did what we needed for her to do. And, you know, a PhD, two MBAs, a couple master's degrees, and my brother, who I call Don't Ask, Don't Tell. But that's a whole other story. But in any case, you know, she did her best, and she had a whole cadre of women who all got divorced around 1960, 61. And between those tribes, there were maybe 30 young people. And I don't think we have a screw-up in the crowd.
No, and it doesn't have to be a screw-up. You know, my mother, I would tell you, raised me from the time I was 11. When my father died suddenly, they came home from a vacation. He had a heart attack and died in our driveway. She did a masterful job. She did a wonderful job. I still say, and I turned out okay. You know, I got some issues, but I turned out okay.
Hey, but we all got issues.
I still say, without a strong male figure in my life, I would have been a different person. And there's nothing wrong with saying that. And they don't have to be mutually exclusive. And it doesn't mean that it's impugning or saying that a single black mother is doing anything wrong. Still doesn't mean that a male shouldn't be there, and vice versa.
But implicitly, often when it's put out that way, it's put out in a way to suggest that the single woman-headed household is somehow deficient.
Then my whole point of this book is then we need to change that narrative. You see, if it's put out there and we accept it, then we're wrong. If we truly believe that's not the story, right? That's incorrect. So now it's time for us to reshape that narrative.
I agree with you fully. So let's back to this book. What was your greatest takeaway? You talked to all these people, 40-some black people. Well, you talk to black people all the time, but 40-some black people, some of whom I've never heard of, like I did hear a T.I.
Ain't nobody in that book you haven't heard of, hardly.
Well, you know me.
I better take that back. You're right.
You know, some stuff.
But T.I. you have heard of.
Kind of halfway. But anyway, what was your greatest takeaway from the book?
I think that the greatest takeaway is twofold. I think it proved to me once again the strength of black people. Mm-hmm. And all the things that we face, and we still overcome it. We still thrive and we still survive. But it also gave me a sense of that we need a black agenda.
We have a black agenda.
No, we do not.
Education,
nope,
economics,
that's not an agenda.
Employment.
That, none of those are agendas.
Okay, so what do you see a black agenda
right?
as? Because we have
okay.
this conversation.
But
you've
that's
had
my point. How many times have we sat on panels? All I'm saying is whatever that agenda becomes, that agenda could be us saying we're all going to tackle one of the ills in our community out of one of those subsets and say we're going to correct it, whether it's police brutality, whether it's making sure that every child grows up and has truly a good education, that's going to be our mantra, that we're going to change that, that we're going to, whatever that agenda becomes, we need one. We've talked about a black agenda since I've known you.
Yeah.
I've never seen one come out. I've never seen us act on one. We know, you know, the great gathering in Gary, Indiana. There was a wonderful gathering in Baltimore some years ago.
That
those wonderful black leaders, George Curry and I, were the only two press people who were allowed in that room. It was a closed door meeting. I'd never been around so many of the people that I admired and grew up with. Even being on the panels I'd been on, this was an extraordinary gathering. We walked away with nothing. I walked away to see human frailty in that room that I didn't calculate for the greats. Who's going to speak first? Who
Ooh,
gets the microphone?
Don't get me started.
But listen, it's human nature, right?
It
Too
is human.
Often we don't want to allow that.
One of my crazy stories is not the Million Man March, but the Million More Movement, when we had a trailer that said VIP. It was not a VIP trailer, well, it kind of was, but it really had a bathroom and some water. Mm-hmm. Negroes were fighting each other over who could get into the VIP trailer, and it was just a bathroom and some water. And so it's, you know, but when people are denied self-actualization, an ego comes to the front of the table, no matter who you are.
All whether that, it's a, absolutely, absolutely. But I just think that we are at a place now that we're, even though the vestiges of slavery are with us.
Enslavement, yes.
We're far enough removed that we need to start to pick up and deal with some of those scars in a different way and move forward. We're further enough from the civil rights movement and segregation, I'm talking just years now, mm-hmm. that we need to start to think about some new narratives that worked then but may not be working now. And so I just want this book to be the spark to figure out what's our next move and then go move toward it. It's not a panacea, it's not a cure-all. You're not gonna read this book and all of a sudden get the key to how to make black folk equal in this country. But what I hope it will be, I mean, it's, look, Stacey Abrams, I'm just looking at the front cover, Eric Holder, Maxine, I mean, yourself is in it. It's all about making sure that we all bring what we have to share to the table in a way that really kind of fits the puzzle piece.
So you put the book out there, you got these 40-some people who have said stuff. No, I did see somebody, I don't know. Who is Charlamagne Tha God?
Okay, we'll work on you.
You'll
a little
work
pop culture
me.
Reference.
Okay.
Charlamagne, it, arguably, is the most popular African-American radio host in the country right now.
We have had the conversation
about the fact that I'm old school. But you are old school.
But anyway. Got this book out there, got a lot of conversations. It's a very rich book, folks. You got to get it. I enjoyed it. Where do you go from here? Is this going to be something that you're going to look at in terms of taking it around the country and continuing the conversation? Or is this just Ed Gordon one and done?
No. Well, I don't know about the book. This may be one and done for that. But we are going to go across the country. We've already started that. I'm here in D.C., we're kicking the book off. It just launched this week, but we'll be going across the country. People are already calling saying, hey, will you come? Will you talk to our group? Will you do? And again, I want those talks to be different. It's fine to give a speech, and that's fine. But as I said, we're asking people to get in groups, read this book, and then come up with something that can change the lives of the people who are in your circle first. Because I tell people, fix you, mm-hmm. then fix your house, mm-hmm. then fix your block, mm-hmm. then your city, then your state, and then, because if we all did that, you know, sometimes problems seem so big and almost insurmountable, but if we start small, the micro rather than the macro,
yeah.
That's how things can change. That's what, again, we saw with the civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a national movement that moved down.
It was a local movement that moved up. So we just have a few more minutes, and I wanted to just ask you, so one of the things I want to encourage you to do is to have the people that you talk to say three solutions, just like mm-hmm. I asked, what are your three solutions, for your community? But the second thing I want to just kind of probe you a little bit on as we look at that is this 2020, you know, this is a year that everybody has been tripping about. We want to get 45 out, everybody, well, not everybody, but certainly those of our ilk would love to see 45 just disappear. And it's a seriously political year. What are your thoughts and prognostications about this year, November, but not only November, you know, where, what do you think is gonna happen?
If you ask me today, I'm afraid. I don't see the Democrats with a plan. Mm-hmm. I see them, they're always a scattered party, right? Rarely. And this is what made Ron Brown so brilliant when he was the head of the DNC and made some things happen. And I was having this discussion yesterday. You know, you can argue about the backroom dealings of politics back in the day, mm-hmm. But that did allow for agendas to be built and movement to happen. You know, it did exclude some people, but so there's give and take of what you trade off there. It is not out of the realm of possibility. I would even say 50-50 right now that Donald Trump could win a second term. And as in the book, Stacey Abrams said, if you think these first 4 years was bad, her words are buckle in if he wins again. And so I think that we have to understand as a community, we probably are the tipping point one way or the other. I tell people, you know, get what works. Buses, fish fry, that got people out to vote with back Obama. Mm-hmm. Not just back in the day. Obama did that. He was smart. You know, people say, oh, you know, he used social media. Yeah, but he used those buses and fish fries. They understood what got people out. Now, the historic nature and, you know, all of that, but there are certain things that still work. We don't have Hillary Clinton for a number of reasons, including she thought just showing up at a black church, taking a picture of LeBron James and Beyonce was going to be enough.
The Beyonce thing was just so sad.
And it wasn't.
Yeah.
And so whoever the nominee ends up being, they've got to talk directly to black folk. And black folk have to be smart enough to realize politics does not end on election day. It should start on election day.
Voting is not the most you can do. It's literally the least you
That's
can
right.
do. And I think that more and more of our people need to see that. So what's going to happen with Stacey Abrams? I just adore that woman. Will she be the vice president or will she be running again for governor?
Yeah, she clearly is wanting to have an elected office. She has suggested that she may take a VP slot. If I had my druthers, because I think she's brilliant, I would ask her probably not to do that.
Exactly. VP is like, you know?
Yeah. Unless you're Dick Cheney. I mean.
Or Joe Biden.
Yeah. Well, I think
Biden had a portfolio.
He had a portfolio, but we knew who was running the show.
Oh,
with
always.
Dick Cheney, we weren't really sure.
Because nobody was running the show.
So I'd love to see her, because look, she should be governor now.
She was governor.
And arguably she is governor by virtue of sheer numbers. But I'd like to see her maybe go into the Senate. I tell you what, I have a hard time answering these questions because politics is so dysfunctional now.
Yeah.
So dysfunctional now. Even if she were to become a senator, there's so much dysfunction on the Hill right now. It's a waste of talent if you send someone talented up there.
You know, Ed, we could probably sit here and talk for another, what, hour or so? 30 years of friendship and association and exchange of ideas. I just adore you and appreciate you. And this book, Conversations in Black, ought to be something that we all take a look at.
I hope so.
Use the kickoff conversations, talk about it. Congratulations and good luck.
And thank you, and thank you for being a part of it. Your voice was much needed in that, and I've always appreciated not only your friendship, but you know your time, because that's what's most valuable, and you've always given that to me. I thank you for it.
Well, appreciate you. This is Malveaux, and we will be back.